Avant-Garde-Arama, 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 Avant-Garde-Arama. Good evening. Thank you all for coming to Avant-Garde-Arama Lands in Woodstock. I'm Charles Dennis, the producer and a performer, and in my Avant-Garde-Arama name, I am Chucky D. We have a wonderful program of short works, and short is the key, that'll occur throughout this space. The first performances, we've seated you closer, and for some of the later performances, we'll be moving because they're gonna have a lot of dance going on here. So, Avant-Garde-Arama. What is Avant-Garde-Arama? Where did the name come from? People want to know. I hope people want to know. Let me take you back. It was the winter of 1980. I was living in the East Village of New York City and dancing and performing, beginning my own career. And a friend of mine, choreographer Charles Moulton, invited me to start using the auditorium of a former public elementary school in the East Village, PS-122. Charlie and his dancers were working there, and he said, there's plenty of extra time, use the space, make something happen. And I started doing my own work, but then I started thinking, let's try to get something going that involves many artists. And so I was sort of thinking of creating a festival. And I had a good friend, Jeffrey Isaac, AKA Zagreus Bowery, because he lived atop the Bowery Savings Bank on the corner of Bowery and Grand Streets. And Zagreus was a visual artist and a musician and an entrepreneur, and we were great buddies. I said, I'm gonna go ask Zagreus' help in organizing this performance festival. And so we were conceiving of a festival where there'd be dance and film and poetry and theater and puppetry and short works, because as Zagreus stressed, one could watch anything if it was short. And so we had the concept, but so what were we going to call this festival? Well, the work was going to be avant-garde, so avant-garde, avant-garde. Avant-garde, avant-garde. Zagreus mentioned he was buying his musical equipment at Accordion-Arama on 14th Street. Arama. Arama, avant-garde, avant-garde. Avant-garde-Arama, so we had the name. We launched Avant-garde-Arama in the spring of 1980. Zagreus designed the posters, I got them printed, ran around distributing them, and we were off and running. Avant-Garde-Arama premiere, April 23rd, 1980. And we did four nights, and we were off and running. And by the way, if you'll see, the second night had somebody who's in the house tonight. Mr. Bob Telson, my good buddy, and musician, played on night two of Avant-Garde-Arama number one. We were off and running. $2.50. Refreshments will be available and dancing afterwards. Avant-Garde-Arama 2 came a month later. Performance, music, dance, film, poetry. Everything subject to change. Avant-Garde-Arama 3, a month later. A fabulous organ of human voices. A month later, Avant-Garde-Arama 4. Rage at the appearance of triumph. We took a break for the summer. We came back in the fall.
with Avant-Garde-Arama 5. And now, Bob Telson wasn't Bob Telson anymore. He was Otis Telson! Avant-Garde-Arama 6, featuring acts such as Christians from Outer Space. Avant-Garde-Arama 7, a host of up-and-coming artists, including, if you will notice, in the lower left corner, Keith Haring. Avant-Garde-Arama 8. For the first time, auditions for future Avant-Garde-Aramas 42nd spots available to audience members. You could audition on stage at the event. Which led to an ongoing tradition at Avant-Garde-Arama, which was called 42nd Street. Audience members could sign up and they could do something. 40 seconds. Moving on. Avant-Garde-Arama returns. And then a miracle happened. Avant-Garde-Arama gave birth to a son. Son of Avant-Garde-Arama. And in that moment, it began to spawn and it attracted followers, supporters, artists who joined the committee, people who wanted to see Avant-Garde-Arama prosper, which it has done for 40 years. May the spirit of Avant-Garde-Arama be in the room and with us forever. So we're going to begin the show in just a moment. There'll be 5 performances, some video and film interludes, and later on in the evening, we'll have something called the Poetry Raffle. Anybody in the house who wants to donate $3 to this hat can have their name thrown in the hat. One name will be chosen later in the evening by our poet of the evening, Mr. Phillip X Levine. And that poet who gets chosen gets their $20 refund. All the proceeds go to family of Woodstock. So, we're about to start. I think everything's in place. Our first performer tonight is Shayna Strype.
To go off and then we will begin. And before we get started, I just want to let you in on a little something. And that is that mountains are not born with names. We're just given them randomly after millions of years of existing. And we're given these names by these tiny little guys. Okay? Now, a guy is like a mountain, like made up of kind of all the same stuff, but much smaller. So small, like you wouldn't believe. And they have the ability to kind of move around and own things and mess things up. I have been named and renamed, and I've had all my insides cut up and dug out and sold. And now I'm back to having no name. I'm just rubble. I know this is going to shock many of you to hear this, but I'm just going to say it, that this is actually a fake mountain, okay? Yeah, I know, it is a costume, okay? But I made it to show you what I used to look like before everything happened and kind of give you a little insider's look until how I got to be like this version, this rubble version of myself. Okay, so we ready to get started? Everyone good? We're ready? Okay, let's do it. All right. Okay, here we go.
We are the voices of the foothills, so listen up close. All the creatures and the plants of our mountain were connected until the day that the office was
Yeah. sapphires, and silver, and gold, and hematite, and clear quartz, and rose quartz, and smoky quartz. My organs, my lifeblood, what keeps me from caving in on myself?
Underground? We worship the devil. God can't reach us down here. If you don't die in a blast, you'll die slowly, incrementally. Your lungs will fill to the brim with dust. Your lips will turn blue, and you'll start to bleed from your mouth. Oh, kiss my ass, Jan, and bring me that extra frothy caramel macchiato before I get nasty. Oh, ah, oh, ah,
oh, ah, oh, ah, oh, ah, oh, ah, oh, ah, oh, ah, oh, ah. Down below, they blasted out her pulmonary trunk. Down below, they blasted out her pulmonary trunk. As the men above, they filled their giant holes with junk.
Thank you.
Phillip X Levine. Thanks, Charles. He referred to me as a poet. I've always kind of
wondered if I was one. And so I sort of have thought of myself as an approximate poet. That manifests in a few different ways, but given that you just showed some haiku, I thought I'd start with a haiku. Here's a lame one, but at least it has the right number of silk chicken. I'm going to share a poem. I like poems that, I think all poems to some extent are invitations. Asking you to join me in this. And this one actually has invitation in the title. And it's titled Invitation to a Nap. This one's not as fun. Invitation to a Nap. Sleeping and dreaming, like breathing, are acts of forgetting and remembering over and over. If you will forget and sleep and dream that we kiss, I will remember the sound of water pouring over stone and forget how simply glass can slice to bone. Now I say, choose to forget and come to me like feather down and spill on me with fingers. Place one hand on my belly and your other wherever you wish. And we will share a laughter so silent our mouths drift open. Okay, I've told you. Now let's remember a meadow where the sky leaks beautiful, melts green to yellow, and forget how easily clouds swallow this prodigal sun. Mm-hmm. So, something else I do is pretty eclectic, and I'm going to lay my cards on the table, as it were. So I have all these little like snippets of things that I wrote in the morning or late at night or I'm not even sure where, while driving. This kind of thing in my youth, and later too. All the people, so these are cards, lots of cards. And each one has something on it, you know, and they're organized a little bit. Like certain suits have certain types of theme things and other suits have. So the first one, all the people I was gonna be when I grew up, they're still here. I'm gonna skip the ones that I read last night because there's a few repeat people here. Let's see. Meeting new people is like arriving in the middle of a movie, except you're allowed to talk. When he said it doesn't get any better than this, he was right, and disappeared with a short popping sound. I'm so distracted, I can't even focus on my obsessions. My aim is true, it's just my choice of targets. At the bar, we walked in smashed. We walked out smasher. let's change piles. I know I don't have a paddle, but it's the quality of the creek that has me puzzled. Please do not disturb more. Skip that one. Hanging on to nothing with everything I've got. That look you gave me How much does it cost? I want to find one that I want to be. In theory, there's no difference between theory and practice. Though in practice, there is. If I had to do it all over again, I'd really complain. We're just ships passing water in the night. I want to read one. I want to find one that I want to read. I want. Okay. Well, I kind of know it. So this is true. When I was young, so young I can only remember remembering, I didn't know what capons were. I also didn't know what capers were. So when I found out that capons were castrated male chickens, I thought that, you know, capers were the byproduct of Life in the Disabled Land. Oh, this one seems so much suitable. I like Andy Warhol and all, but there's something around him that's kind of funny. And this Andy Warhol exhibit at the Whitney, January 17th, 1998. Shall we say that it's great? Let's say it's great. It's great. So the next one, the last one of those cards, will introduce the next poem. It's actually, I have a body of work that are more like, I call them prose songs. Hmm. Prose is prose, and poetry is everything else, I like to say. But I met this woman once, and she said, let's get together soon. At the time, I didn't realize she meant soon as in never. But it led to this poem, which is titled, funny enough, Soon. And it's a prose poem, so it has less line breaks than your regular poem. Soon. Soon. The day is light. And the day is long and has many rooms between the hours. And the day also travels a long arc up and up and then back down again from middle. And a calculus can count the length and width and area beneath this curve and tell us this place is large and has rooms for many things, many that we know and many more still. There's room for joy with her large, funny hat that bounces and she bounces with laughter or something like it. And sadness, too, can have a room. She who likes to sleep, to take naps in the afternoon between top and shadow. And today is also a place I know and go to as if returning. And so I know there is a point or place or time for you and me along this curve of day, a place by a fire where we can burn all our old stories of loss and failure and warm our feet while we do it, because this fire is warm and soothes. And this fire is also hot and dances. And I see it in your eyes, and I know it is in mine. And by this fire, I can watch your fingers curl and uncurl and think perhaps they wish to touch. And I can feel mine curl and uncurl too, even as I think to hold them still. But they will not, as they have 10 hearts and minds and desires of their own and wish to find their mates in yours. So one by one to 5 and 10, they arch across the spaces there between us, that is, the spaces between mine and yours and all that could be ours, like your 10, with their ten, their hearts, minds, desires, and all the same as all of mine, and all that dances there in this fire. And soon together ten and ten close and open. Open and close together again. And soon beads of moisture gather there in their folding, and glistening collect a light. Then I risk to think they will be sweet when tasted. But it is to be waited for like dessert, for is not waking the sweetest taste of all? For what is it but anticipation that brings a mouth to water, that brings the tongue to swelling, purses lips, and opens eyes to wide and wider still? So I am feasting in this waiting. And if we share this waiting, then so we share a feasting. And in this way, a feast is made. And by this, my heart is quickened. And soon it also pauses, and soon again quickens, and soon again pauses, and soon this hardens, and soon this softens, and soon between the beating, and between the pausing, and between the hard, and between the soft, soon there would be touching, yes, soon there will be touching, and yes, soon there will be touch, and soon I will, yes, soon we will, yes, soon, soon.
Are they
So I came up with the me monitor. And it can tell you whether they're talking about you or not about me. And that can be very helpful in those awkward moments. Thank you.
Isobel Seabrook, and we ask you to move your benches back to the edges of the room so we can open up the space. And we'll begin her performance momentarily.
Thank you. Sick and tired of not knowing what your plants are thinking and feeling? Until now, us humans have been quite limited in our ability to communicate with our botanical counterparts. Here at EcoEmotion, we give you the tools you need to converse with those special plants in your life. Introducing Plant Chat. Just hook the leaves up to our highly sensitive receptors and listen in amazement as your plant chats with you. Hi! Oh, so it's mad. Is it mad at me? With our portable adapter, you can now take Plant Chat out into the world. Plant Chat could be yours for only 6 easy payments of $19.99. Call now and we'll throw in the sinusoidal soil receiver so you can listen to your green friends wherever, whenever, hands-free. Operators are standing by, so call now.
Call 1-800-977-0934 and get ready to chat with your plants today with Plant Chat.
Call now.
Now is the time of the evening. That's right. You know, after sitting for a while, sometimes we need to get off of our chairs. This is what I call get up off of that thing. Get up off of that thing. Get up off of that chair. Get up off of that chair. Get up.
Get Thank you.
out of the 400 injuries. Here it is. Okay. Otis.
Yeah.
Oh! Otis. The stage is yours.
Ready? Sex with my ex? Sent me to the chiropractor. I never considered a love of peace such a damaging factor. Sex with my ex? Sent me to the chiropractor. Little girl gets a satisfaction. Leaving my neck on traction. Sex with my ex. Hey, baby, like I just can't help myself. Can't help helping myself to more. You got me naked in a brand new cowboy hat and crawling across the floor. Now, some like to ride, lay back in the saddle, a Ruby Tooth Rodeo. But her love stings like the one from the pile of a kayak in Idaho. Sex with my ex, sex with the chiropractor. Never considered the love of peace such a damaging factor. Yes, sex with my ex, sent me to the chiropractor. Doc says, ain't no cure. Long as you go back for more sex with my ex. I'll never forget when we first met. She was sweet as a honeybee. A hug and then a kiss in missionary position, satisfaction guaranteed. While I was safe at home, she was playing the field, but she found out, I found out the score. Hit me in the head with a baseball bat, walked right out the door. Sex with my ex.
On the matter of the 36 years between Emmett Till and Rodney King and the 29 years between Rodney King and Breonna Taylor.
Okay, so I was 15 years old on March 3rd, 1991.
Not me, not me. I was born free, got everything I need in a pocket full of dreams. Not sure, don't know what the future holds, but it's looking real bright. And I got a lot of goals. Struggle, struggle is a part of my life. Everybody got it and it don't feel nice. I learn, I grow from what I've been through. Not me, I'm free and you could be too.
And I remember the Rodney King beating because it had a huge impact on me. It like changed the trajectory of the person that I was to become.
My black future is bright as can be. My ancestors gave me everything I need. I keep my head up so my soul will stay free, like lions and cheetahs and birds in the breeze.
What I remember is I was getting dressed for school and my mom had the TV on. And I was just kind of getting dressed and I was walking around the house and I was, you know, doing all the things a 15-year-old does before they get ready for high school. And I kept on walking by the television and kind of looking at what's going on. And then it just started to look so crazy to me that I had to sit down on the edge of her bed and really just look at what I thought I was seeing on the television. And so my mom kept getting ready and I was like halfway ready. And so it was time for her to like get ready to go. And we were all going to walk out together. And she said, you know, come on, Adia, let's go. Let's leave. It's time to go to school. And I was like, I'm not going to school. And she was like, what you mean you're not going to school? Like, you have to go to school. And I was like, but look at what's happening. Like, I don't understand, like, how this can happen. Like, still, I thought this was, like, things that happened, like, a very long time ago. And so I'm not going to school. Like, it's crazy out there. And we lived in Northern California, so it wasn't like we were in L.A. Like, things weren't burning and there wasn't all this, like, you know, angst between the Korean folks and the black folks. But it was some things going on that side, you know. And I was like, what am I to do next? Like, I'm not really understanding. Like, I'm going to go into the world when this craziness is going on. And my mom was like, okay, you know, it's crazy. I lived through the time of desegregation. And yeah, it's crazy, but you got to keep going. And I was like, okay. And she was like, so you got to go to school. So I got my stuff. I went to school. And when I went to school, they had scheduled this assembly where they were talking about everything that was happening. And, you know, everybody was standing up and saying their feelings and saying how they felt on the matter of black men thriving and dying and being murdered and living. On the spectacular matter of white bodies receiving funding to facilitate and set up spaces that showcase black suffering bodies and performative puppet practices of diversity, equity, and inclusion and belonging. on the matter of white folks that are really down and not sure how to move forward in an authentic and cycle-breaking way. On the matter of privileged people of color that embody the psychology and religious beliefs of racist white men from the past, present, and future.
I have a chance to live, so I will risk whatever it takes to say his name.
I had this white friend, and she decided she was going to use me as her black friend example. And so she stood up and she was like, and this is all happening and it's so terrible and I would never, you know, and Adia is my friend. And I was like, whoa. So I jumped up, and I never was a jumper upper before this point. And I jumped up and I was like, would you die so my people could be free? And it just like came out of me, like out of my face in front of like the whole school in an assembly. And she was like, what? And I was like, would you die so that my people could be free? And she was so, I think, I don't know what she was feeling. She just looked so stunned and hurt that she just didn't say anything, and her eyes filled up with tears. And I was like, exactly. And then I just sat down. And then from that moment on, I remember feeling like everything was different. I remember like thinking like, okay, I'm not going to relax my hair anymore. I think that's just getting caught up in something that's not really me. And that's like not like my authentic self. Like that's not how my hair grows out of my head. I remember making this decision, like I'm not fighting no more black folks. Cause you know, in high school, you'd be petty, be going to school. Who is the deal? I'm gonna fight her, you know, all this stuff. I was like, I told the people that wanted to fight me, I was like, whatever happens, I'm not gonna fight you. Like I don't believe in fighting other people of color and black people, cause it's just too much going on in the world and we don't need to be fighting. I just changed. And so the Rodney King beating was a really significant moment in my life, because it showed me a side of the United States or this country that I just wasn't seeing on a daily, I was, even though I was, you know, an urban youth from a single parent home, and you know, I'm black, I still was very privileged. I had a very privileged childhood. And so this moment was like, it's like no matter what you do, like no matter how much education you get, no matter how much you do the right thing, no matter how much you follow the rules, like it can all go down at any moment because somebody decided to call us something called black. On the matter of women weathering the storms of patriarchy, on the matter of black men weathering the storms of white women that weathered the storms of white men, on the matter of black, Latinx, Asian, and indigenous women that work in service to people that possess power and privilege, on the matter that we are all privileged in ways that others are not, on the matter of ghosts, on the matter of ancestors that have never been able to rest peacefully, on the matter of watching and hearing and thinking and doing while being watched by people easily bored by the repetition and tedious labor it takes to birth new life, on the matter of time-consuming and expensive practices and systems that value healing from the inside out, on the matter of fatigue, exhaustion, fury, and boredom and burnout.
My black future is bright as can be. My ancestors gave me everything I need. I keep my head up so my soul will stay free, like lions and cheetahs and birds in the breeze. My black future is bright as can be. My ancestors gave me everything I need. I keep my head up so my soul will stay free, like lions and cheetahs and birds in the breeze. In the breeze, in the breeze.
This is all designed to dance. I'm going to do a couple of numbers, and then Bob's coming up, and then you're all supposed to get up and dance like you did last night.
Yeah. Woo-hoo.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.